Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the second meeting of the Justice Subcommittee on Policing in 2017. Apologies have been received from John Finney and Margaret Mitchell. Agenda item one is a decision on taking business in private. Are the committee content to take item three in private? This is consideration of the evidence heard at today's meeting. And is the committee also content that consideration of our letter to the Justice Committee and our forward work programme also be taken in private at the meeting on the 2nd of February? Are we agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you. Agenda item two is the Stop and Search Code of Practice Appointed Day Scotland Regulations 2017 draft. The purpose of this session is to increase our own understanding of this issue and to help inform a letter to the Justice Committee, who will be considering whether to approve or disapprove these regulations next month. And I know that the Justice Subcommittee in the last session took a very keen interest in Stop and Search, and this is one of the reasons why we are considering the draft regulations today. And can I welcome John Scott, QC, Chair of the Independent Advisory Committee on Stop and Search, Assistant Chief Constable Mark Williams from Police Scotland, Pauline McIntyre, Member of the Independent Advisory Group and Parliamentary and Policy Officer for the Children and Young People's Commissioner for Scotland, and Callum Steele from the Scottish Police Federation. And given the time constraints that we have today, I am grateful to John Scott QC for agreeing not to make an opening statement, and I intend to move straight to questions. We have about an hour for this evidence session, and can I refer members to paper one, which is a note from the clerk, and paper two, which is a spice paper. And can I perhaps just start by putting things into a bit of context and ask our witnesses a very general opening first question. And I'd be interested in their comments and whether they are satisfied that the code is a significant improvement in the way that Stop and Search will operate in Scotland, or are there particular elements of the code which are giving cause for concern? And I'd quite like to start with John Scott.
Thank you. There are no particular parts of the code which are giving cause for concern. The drafting process for this code has perhaps been different from many others, in that I think ordinarily the legal directorate would be tasked with drafting it. And what happened here was that although we had assistance from the legal directorate, and Craig French in particular, the whole of the advisory group were involved in the redrafting of the code from the original draft that was attached to our initial report. We also had great assistance from the National Stop and Search Unit of Police Scotland, input from academics such as Kath Murray and Genevieve Lennon, and other groups with a particular interest in children and young people, and Pauline coordinated our new chapter on that. David Harvey, the Crown Agent, drafted the section on vulnerable people. So the code, as it was laid before the Parliament, has changed quite a bit from the original draft that was based fairly heavily on Pace Code A, but it now better reflects the situation in Scotland. And I think it also addresses the fact that it's intended for more than one audience. It's not simply supposed to be a working document for police officers, although it is that, but it's also intended as guidance for the public, for specific groups as well, children and young people, and to address what I've seen during the last period of 18 months or 2 years, and in my day job as well, as a really poor awareness of rights and responsibilities on the part of our citizens. So ideally, I would like to see the code as part of civic education in schools, so that actually to address what was a power imbalance before, which affected the question of consent, we're way beyond that stage. This is probably what I would like to describe as the final of the first steps, but an important first step in putting us in a much, much healthier position than we were just a very short number of years ago. And I should record my gratitude to Police Scotland for the very great willing that they've shown to get to the stage that we're at, so that even ahead of the introduction of the code, the position is significantly better than it was before.
That's very helpful, thank you. Liam, did you want to come in just now before I bring in anyone
else?
No,
I'm happy to follow with an answer.
perhaps, Mark, would you like to perhaps comment now?
Yes, in answer to your question, yes, Police Scotland is satisfied that this is a significant improvement in how we will codify and apply stop and search in the future when of course the code is passed by Parliament. We're very grateful to John Scott and the IAG for consulting with us and working closely with us throughout the drafting of the code, and we've been very much involved in the detail of it, in supporting that drafting process, and it has indeed been a key part of it over the piece. Of course, when the code is passed and we apply it operationally, then we will very closely monitor and evaluate its effectiveness, how frontline officers will use it in practice, because it's very important that it does meet the needs that it's set out to deliver. I'm confident that will very much be the case. And of course, there are and will be reviews built into the code over the period of its existence, and after 6 months, 12 months and thereafter, we'll regularly review how it's being applied. And if there are any areas whatsoever that give us any cause for concern, we'll be able to gather that evidence and bring it back for appropriate scrutiny, review and consultation in the future. So, in short, yes, we are satisfied that it will lead to a significant improvement in how we apply stop and search in Scotland.
Thank you. Pauline Callum.
From our perspective, we're particularly pleased to see the chapter included on children and young people. We think, as John has alluded to as well, that there have been massive steps forward in terms of Police Scotland and their rights-based approach to a number of areas of work. And I think they should be commended on that, because there has been significant progress in a short period of time as well. The other thing from this process that I find particularly useful is that the way that the Scottish Government have approached consultation with children and young people. They have done so by engaging with groups such as the Children's Parliament and the Scottish Youth Parliament, and they have done so at a very early stage in the process. And I think that has been incredibly helpful, because normally when children and young people are consulted, it's often when adults have created something on their behalf and they want to know their views. The process that was taken for this code of practice was, it was very much about shaping it with their views in mind. We started from that process. So I would say that Stephen Jones from the Scottish Government again should be commended for the work that he's done on this, because it has been quite groundbreaking and I think actually sets a tone for a range of work that could be taken forward in future.
Callum.
Yeah, thank you, Convener, and at the risk of breaking the love in the room, the Scottish Police Federation has had a fairly strident position on the issue of stop and search for a long period of time. And before I answer the very specific question of whether the code will lead to an improvement on it, I think it's important that I try and lay that out again, because there are some very heavy nuances in our position. The first one is that we believe that the practice that was heavily promoted by the Police Service of Scotland effectively poisoned the well of police tactics and the ability to engage with large elements of our society. We roundly dismissed the notion that the well-publicised figure of 500,000 stop and searches were undertaken in Police Scotland, and I think others, including HMICS, subsequently conceded that our position was correct. We were ardent critics of the target approach within the service, which was perverting the behaviours, and we have no doubt, or we have little doubt, that had it not been for that, we would probably not have found ourselves dealing with this particular issue. The issue of consensual stop and search was, of course, is a large part what the code was designed to overcome, given the provisions of Section 56 of the Criminal Justice Scotland Act that was passed recently, is something that we have great concerns about. Now, it might be something of a moot point, given that Parliament has already legislated in that area, but certainly our belief is, and the belief of our members, is that will have a very limiting effect on the ability, not for the exclusively for the detection of crime, but for the prevention of crime, which is something that is often overlooked in this particular regard. So now turning to the specifics of the code, like those that have gone before me, I would like to pay a tremendous testimony to John Scott for the work that he's done in this. I know it's not been easy. I know he's come up against some fairly strident views, most notably our own, I would think. But I have to say he approached the Scottish Police Federation with courtesy and willingness to listen, certainly in all the dealings that I had with him. At the risk of repeating what's laid out in the written submission that we made, we think that, you know, by and large, there are lots of things in the code that are uncontroversial. There are bits that are unnecessary, and I think to some extent that might relate to the fact that it aims at more than one audience, which is to some extent also a slight peculiarity given the provisions of the expectations of the code as were laid out in Section 73. We have some concerns that there are still remain some grey areas, and ultimately the limiting or the removal of the capability of people to cooperate with the police in a free and unfettered fashion is something that we believe will not ultimately lead to a safer Scotland.
I'm going to bring in Liam and then Stuart with supplementaries. Liam.
Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you for your written evidence, your time this morning or this afternoon. I think as well as paying tribute to my predecessor, Alison McInnes, in relation to where we've got to now, clearly Dr. Kath Murray has played an absolutely pivotal role. I mean, she's described the Code of Conduct as a major milestone in terms of reform of stop and search. But interestingly, there appears to have already been quite a shift in terms of practice. I think the recent figures suggest there's been a 93% reduction in stop and search and a 99.5% almost eradication of consensual stop and search. So I'd be interested to know, particularly I think from Mark Williams and Callum Steele, whether you think we're now at a level of stop and search which going forward would be your expected level of stop and search, or whether it's too early to tell.
I think at this stage, obviously when the code is introduced, when passed by Parliament, there will be a new framework around which stop and search is applied. We have worked very hard over recent years to move in the direction that the code will take us in terms of a presumption on statutory stop and search, not consensual stop and search, hence the significant reductions that you've mentioned there in your question. And whilst that has undoubtedly now moved us to a position where only, as we speak, about 2 or 3% of all stop and search are consensual, and that will of course cease when the code comes into place, I think it's too early to say what that will mean in terms of overall volumes of stop and search. What is important is that the framework facilitates good engagement and communication on the part of police officers right across Scotland when they're dealing with members of the public, and that when it's appropriate and justified and reasonable, they feel confident to use stop and search as a tactic in the right circumstances and when dealing with the right incidents. That is what we're very much trying to achieve by way of applying the code. And as we speak, we're training every frontline officer in Scotland to better engage, to better communicate, to understand the powers that they do have, and to work within the code so that when it does come into place, we're ready to apply it effectively and professionally, and in a way that puts communication and engagement first, but always remembers that where it's justified and reasonable, they have a power that they can use.
And I mean, I don't want to steal Callum Steele's thunder here, but in a sense, the reductions we've seen in overall levels of stop and search, that's happened, and to my knowledge, hasn't seen a spike or a noticeable change in crime detection or indeed prevention. So the assumption from that would have to be that there haven't been significant issues arising from a reduction in a tactic, as you say, which I think all of us accept is still a legitimate and very necessary tactic under certain circumstances.
Yeah. And I think it's too early to say, and what we also appreciate, and I think Dr. Kath Murray lays it out very clearly in her written submission, is that it's actually very difficult to draw direct correlations academically between the volume of stop and search and the levels of crime that prevail in society. It has been tried over many decades, but never have we actually been able to isolate out, say, violence and stop and search and link them together in a way which justifies either an increase, a decrease, or a link between the two. We know that tackling crime in Scotland is a complex issue. Stop and search is a very narrow tactic that can be applied in some scenarios to certain incidents, but it certainly isn't the only one that can be applied. So I think it will be, it's too early to answer that question, in truth. I think what we will do is ensure that we have officers trained across Scotland to deal with the code and to apply it as best as possible, and we will evaluate and we will review it after 6 months, after a year and thereafter, to ensure that it's delivering what we expect it to deliver. And if there are any challenges in there that we identify, then it's for the service to, again, credibly evidence them and bring them back to the IG, to the government and to others, so that we can deal with them then.
Callum, did you want to add something?
And I think, to some extent, Liam MacArthur's question maybe highlights the very real difficulty we have of dining off the fruit from the poison tree, because that 93% reduction is based on numbers that were largely made up. So we're claiming reductions from things that weren't real in the first place, and that in itself is inherently problematic. And you know, I'm conscious that we're trying to make progress on issues of today rather than constantly harking back at the problems of the past. But when we were recording, for example, a seizure of alcohol from one young person who might have been in a group of 10 or 20 as 20 positive searches, when in fact nobody had been searched, we're not resulting in any reductions in the use of search. We're just making sure that we're recording things in a different manner. So those statistics, you know, the 93% reduction is in itself a false flag. They are what might be termed topically alternative facts, as in they're not factual at all. The issue of causation versus correlation is one which, of course, I don't think we're ever going to be able to answer, and we could set academics on the course for, I think, probably 100 years, and they're never going to be able to get to a position that would support that. But anecdotally, and I appreciate that that's about as much use as alternative facts. Our members are reporting to us just now that in certain areas of the country, they are coming under pressure from their commanders because violence is on the increase in their areas. Whilst I suspect it is too early to say that there is a causation or indeed a correlation, there is undoubtedly the fact that pressure is coming to bear at this point in time. And even yesterday, and I know that John Scott will know what I'm about to say because I mentioned him in a tweet yesterday evening. Even yesterday, the BBC carried a report that there is a knife crime committed in the UK once every 15 minutes. It is difficult to see that we are going to be improving that by getting to a situation where there is a belief that the only time we're going to be searching those that might be suspected of having weapons or have been in the habit of carrying weapons is every single time we've got a specific piece of intelligence or information to support that. That's why I'm so concerned that losing this, and again, I acknowledge it's a moot point, but losing this consensual approach to search to some extent, ties the hand of police officers and how we deal with members of the public, not least because of some of the issues that are laid out in the code. And the opportunity to discourage through the notion that there was a likelihood of search in the first instance is something that has gone. And I believe strongly that there is a very strong likelihood our communities will suffer as a consequence.
Okay. Thank you. Stuart.
Thank you. Could I ask Mark Williams? The searches which will not now be made, was there a bureaucratic burden associated with them that will now be eliminated, the recording and reporting?
We record all stop and searches that are recordable stop and searches, and obviously the code defines them clearly. Every stop and search that is carried out in Scotland is audited and checked and accounted for by the National Stop and Search Unit. We audit 100% of them. It's very important to us that our data is credible and that our information is credible. And we will continue to do that once the code is introduced, as we are doing at this present time. When officers stop and search a member of the public, yes, there is a requirement on them to record that activity and to do so on the stop and search database. So if we are carrying out less stop and search activity, then there are fewer getting recorded, and therefore there is less bureaucracy around it in terms of the officers themselves when they record it. However, what is very important, and I think it strikes at the heart of the code and what it's about, is that we are seen to be legitimately acting, that we have the trust and confidence of the public, that we do assure the data we have, that it is credible and properly recorded and analysed. And I think the journey we have been on over a number of years now puts us in a place where we can be confident of that fact. And indeed, every 3 months we publish all of the data on stop and search nationally. We publish it online for the public to scrutinise and study, as well as others. And of course, that will continue as we introduce the code and start applying it. In addition, local area commanders across Scotland will be furnished with specific information for their own areas of responsibility that will be shared with scrutiny committees and other accountable bodies to allow them to further delve into the detail of activity in those local areas, which I think is appropriate in terms of how it's applied locally, because that will be different across Scotland based on the different needs that communities have. So, in answer to your question, yes, there is a correlation between recording and bureaucracy and officer time, but it's equally very important that the data we have is accurate, that it's audited, that it's accountable, that it's published and open and transparent. And we've been very, very committed to ensuring that is the case, and that will continue when the code is introduced.
I'm just testing the assertion that's come from the Federation that, and I quote, it will be a heavy bureaucratic burden. And I just wanted, perhaps very concisely, given that we've eliminated some of the burden, but we're increasing the recording associated with the searches that remain, what your sense of is what the balanced effect of that is in terms of bureaucracy and the amount of work, effort that has to be devoted to that. Fairly concisely, if I may.
Yeah, the recording is electronic. It's done on a database. It's computerised. It's pretty short and sharp and doesn't take a lot of time to carry out. Of course, at the time of the stop and search, there will also be a receipt issued to the member of the public who is being searched, so there is a record kept. I think the benefits that are brought around by that accountability and legitimacy outweigh any small bureaucracy that goes with recording that activity.
I'm sure we'll come back to benefits later.
Thank you. Thanks, convener. Yes, I just wanted to explore with you the principles of the code. And to summarise, that they are in accordance with law, necessary and proportionate. I'm just wondering if you could tell me if you think those principles are sufficiently clear enough for officers to be able to use their judgment and to establish whether the rights of an individual in a particular circumstance outweighs the perceived benefits of a search. Is there anything there you feel could be a bit ambiguous in those principles?
I don't believe that there is anything that is ambiguous in that sense. The principles of necessity, of proportionality, of justification are principles that are very, very well known within the police service. They feature in a great many of the judgments and decisions that police officers take every day. And of course, we entrust our frontline officers with a huge burden, that burden of judgment, but importantly, the burden of discretion as well. And we trust them to act in a whole host of different situations and a whole host of different incidents to deal fairly with the situation that they're involved with. And of course, the principles of fairness, integrity and respect underpin that behaviour as the force values. So I am very comfortable that the principles governing stop and search and the ones that are articulated in the code are appropriate, are necessary, and do allow for that justification and that necessity to be evidenced in each and every incident that they're dealing with.
Thank you. Does anyone else have a view on that?
My impression is exactly the same. Those three, lawful, necessary and proportionate, we also get them from the European Convention, and there's considerable familiarity in Scotland, the Parliament, Government, Police Scotland, with those principles. It ties in, as I understand it, with other aspects of training of police officers, and that's one of the things that the National Stop and Search Unit has assisted us with, so that it does blend with other training, and they're not being presented with an entirely new way of approaching the question of a defensible decision.
Okay, just a small sorry, Callum, did you want to come in?
Thank you. I'm happy to wait for the next question.
Just to pick up on one aspect of it, we're talking about necessity. Perhaps you could explain just the difference between locating a harmful item and confirming the possession of an illegal item. Is that one and the same thing, or is that kind of a different? Is it just the terminology that's a bit confusing?
Which page or section of the code is that? I've got a lovely folder that's got all of my paperwork in it, but it's not here, unfortunately.
It's part of the necessary principles.
Yes, helpful. I've got it. Thank you. Yeah. It may be the same thing, but I suspect there will be situations where it could be two separate approaches.
So it's really just a question of the way it's worded, but it essentially means the same thing.
Yes, I mean. Uh-huh. I suppose what I would suggest is that in a given scenario, for example, if the necessity of the search is required to locate a harmful item, it may be that based on intelligence and other information that a police officer has, they believe a member of the public is in possession of something that's harmful or illegal, and therefore they will stop and search them to ascertain if that is the case. That would be locating it. The alternative there, in terms of confirming the possession of, would be, for example, where they actually perhaps see the person with something that's put in their pocket, or it is intimated to them that they're in possession of something that is illegal by a witness or another member of the public, and then you are confirming that that is the case. Yeah. So it is, it's a subtle use of language, but I think both are appropriate.
Will you excuse me? I wonder if I might illustrate it thus. They are quite different things. An unloaded handgun would be illegal, but not necessarily harmful. But a pen equipped to stab someone in the eye is not illegal, but could be harmful. So it does strike me they are different things, both of which are necessary. Is that a fair comment?
It is, but of course it's how you use that item may generate the legality or otherwise.
John Scott's point about this being the familiarity with the code being picked up in training, is the expectation that this is going to require additional training for officers, and if so, whether that could be quantified, or whether or not Police Scotland's confident that familiarity and a degree of comfort with the new code is something that's just going to be sort of brought in through the standard ongoing initial and ongoing training that police officers undergo.
Very happy to quantify that for you. We are training all frontline police officers, that's constables, sergeants and inspectors. They're undergoing two forms of training. First of all, there's a pre-half training day, which is online. It's done through a mechanism we use called Moodle, where they undertake some online training around the code and its application. Thereafter, there's a half day of face-to-face training with trainers around the code, its application, and some of the key elements of it. Key elements of that would include, for example, engagement, communication, with a particular emphasis on children and young people. It covers issues like unconscious bias and goes into some detail about the lawfulness of their activity, statutes and how they might be applied. So we are taking training very seriously. Over 8,000 officers now have been trained, and obviously there's still several thousand to be done, and that will be finished prior to the code being introduced. And that involves a half day training face-to-face and the precursor training, which is online.
And all the training is mandatory?
Yes, it is for frontline police officers. Yes, every officer in Scotland will be trained in advance of the code being introduced.
Okay, that's lovely. Callum, did you want to come in?
Yes. Thank you, Convener. Just before we get too far away from the questions that Rona Mackay asked about the code and its relevance and necessary and proportionate views on in terms of the law. I think in many cases it actually goes beyond what the law provides. I mean, if we look, for example, at the Code of Practice requirements in terms of Section 73 of the 2016 Act, it doesn't, for example, talk about the requirement of the Code to set the standard for which constables are to be scrutinised and evaluated. Those are matters that are properly determined by the Chief Constable and shouldn't be determined in any code. And of course, it's right and proper that the Chief Constable sets those standards in accordance with the parameters and governance expectations laid upon him or her by the Scottish Police Authority. And in some regards, I think that this code actually goes beyond that and it steps into an area that is not properly in its remit and therefore goes beyond the limit of the law. But there is probably one real area that I know everyone around this table recognises, and for understandable reasons I can see why the code seems to suggest that in one area in particular, the provisions of the legislation, the 2016 Act, particularly Section 56, should be set aside, and that is in respect of the protection of life. The 2016 Act says no search shall be carried out unless in accordance with a statutory provision, yet the code says, forget that. If you need to save a life, you can search regardless. Now, I can understand why the code says that, and I can understand why police officers would want to do that, but one definitely sits against the other. And I suppose to some extent this goes, it would take us into a whole host of discussions about many of the unintended consequences of what would fall out from the things that Parliament has legislated for. And I also want to touch very briefly on the question of bureaucracy that was asked by Stuart Stevenson, and I think it's difficult on one hand to reconcile the statement that you have, you know, complete trust in police officers and the ability to use the discretion, when we then ally that to the previous statement that we have 100% audit on activities in respect of stop and search. Those two don't, to me, sit side by side. But the issue of bureaucracy is one which is very, very relevant and hugely salient to the way in which police officers undertake their day-to-day activities. If we are faced with a process which is overly onerous in terms of the bureaucratic expectation, whether on the street, whether when someone returns to a station, or whether then in responding to the stop search, effectively compliance unit, that in its own right is going to dissuade individuals from being involved in the activity in the first place. And that in its own right cannot be understated. Prior to the police service making a right royal horlicks of this whole issue, the whole approach to the recording of stop and search was largely tick box. It wasn't onerous, it wasn't difficult, and of course to some extent that allowed the ability for numbers to be completely made up. But when you move from that to something which is so heavily specific in its expectations, that creates a bureaucracy that will be off-putting and discourage people from using their powers of stop and search and sustain an industry which will, I dare say, journalists will feed off forever. It's terrific from that perspective. But ultimately, if Parliament determines that these are the kind of activities that you want the police resources to be utilised for, then you know the police service will end up having to fall in line accordingly.
John or Mark, do you want to come in on any of the points that Callum has made?
Yes, please. I think that we're in a position where there's going to be a better use of police resources than what we saw previously with unrestrained or even targeted use of non-statutory stop and search, where the chances of finding something were far less than in a situation where it was properly intelligence-led and based on reasonable grounds to suspect. So, previously, officers were engaged to a significant extent, albeit because of poor counting, the accurate figures are unknown, in searching for things that weren't there. It is about getting a balance as well. There's a level of bureaucracy required in order for proper accountability and scrutiny. And one of the problems that the Federation were early to identify was the lack of proper accountability and scrutiny in this area. And it's bearing in mind as well that while stop and search is an important police tactic that for which there is still and always will be a place, being just one of a number of measures, the majority of searches will still involve nothing being found. And so this code has to cater not simply for those who are actually in possession of illegal items and are found in possession of those after a proper search for which there's reasonable grounds, but also for a huge number of people as yet the baselines haven't been determined, so we don't know what the right number is, but we'll find that out, I think, over time, and it may change. But the code has to cover the situations where officers are engaged with individuals, may have reasonable grounds, they don't need to be right about those, but they search someone, they don't find anything, and how the person is left at the end of it, as a result of the code, I think will be a far better place than previously, where the question that we were given by a lot of young people was, why were we searched? And they didn't have an answer to that. And as a result of the code, they should have an answer to that. Can I deal briefly also with Callum's point about the protection of life situations? And Callum is right about this, and it is specifically flagged up in the supplementary report from the advisory group on pages 8 and 9. So we have identified that ideally there would be legislation. There wasn't a legislative slot, but we felt a sense of responsibility to officers because of the changes that we were involved in. And therefore, there's a comfort from the other pieces of legislation and Article 2 of the European Convention all read together. While there's no specific power of search in those situations, it may well be that in the course of the review process, this Parliament, this committee perhaps, will review that and will allot a specific power to deal with that situation. But in the meantime, I think what we've put in the supplementary report is intended as a comfort to officers who are asking the right questions and who at training are saying, what's my power to do this?
Just a wee observation. There is precedent in the Air Navigation Order which explicitly says that pilots may override any rule or regulation in the interests of safety. Explicitly.
Thank you very much. Can I ask now about the code at paragraph 610, where it states that constables must ensure, so far as is reasonably practicable, that the person understands why they are to be searched and what that search will involve. Can you explain to me in layman's terms exactly what that means? Because if I think of an example of someone that has perhaps a mental health condition, and it almost seems to me as if we're getting into a kind of grey area. Where is the line drawn between we've done as much as we can and the person still doesn't understand? Where do you stop?
That I think the code is intended to leave a great deal of the assessment there to the individual officer. Mm-hmm. And it is a hugely complicated mm-hmm. area, which I think is touched on in some of the other work of the Justice Committee and perhaps of this committee, and evidence that Callum has given about frontline policing, because the identification of different types of vulnerability is a hugely complicated area. It might be that as a result of healthcare professionals working for several weeks, that a full assessment, or months, a full assessment can be made. But officers are very often called upon to make very quick decisions. May not be able to fully identify particular communication issues or vulnerability issues or understanding issues. The reasonably practicable is there because the code is intended to make sure that efforts are made, but clearly officers cannot guarantee that a person will understand, and there may be hidden or not obvious reasons for that. So this is going as far as we can, but recognising that it would simply be impossible to guarantee. Obviously, ideally, everyone would fully understand, but in the absence of that, I think this is we've gone as far as we can, recognising the very difficult job involved.
Callum.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. I think this is a really, really interesting issue, and I think to some extent is one worthy of further exploration of the question of vulnerability, because this question is, of course, predicated on the notion that a search is going to be undertaken and the understanding capability of the individual with which we are dealing. But we as police officers come across a lot of people on a daily basis who may find themselves in a situation, and we may find ourselves in a situation where the ability to communicate and their ability to understand is somewhat limited, and there may be concerns about their safety, their well-being, just because of the general nature of the environment in which they find themselves or in which police officers are dealing with them. Nothing criminal, nothing to suggest that they are at harm to themselves, but clearly something that would leave individuals uneasy about leaving them behind if we're not able to establish their identity. So even the fact that we are now not able to say, do you mind if I have a look in your pockets to see if you can either find a driving license, a bank card, something to help find out where you are, where you might be able to belong to help then, you know, maybe if it's necessary to find someone to come and help you. The fact that we don't have that anymore is going to be problematic. And then, of course, there are the questions of what happens if you find something illegal whilst undertaking that activity to try and support the individual in the first place, and how that sits in respect of the overall provisions of the code about not undertaking any search unless it's in accordance with a statutory provision.
Pauline, could I just ask you specifically in relation to children,
yes,
what impact do you think this may have?
Well, there is a specific section within the Children and Young People section that deals with this, and I think it was really to make it clear, in particular in relation to children and young people, that it was important that other options were considered to safeguard the child or young person, so that it shouldn't automatically be assumed that a search is the best way of safeguarding that child. So it might be a case of taking them home to their parents, finding someone else who can support them, and then taking it forward in that way. I think, as John has alluded to, we were very careful when considering this as the group to look at where there was flexibility. We had to balance often the rights of the people that this code would affect against the operational side of things in terms of the way that the police would be operating on a day-to-day basis. And I think there was a very careful balancing act that happened there. And I hope that the code as it is now captures that and allows for enough flexibility in that individual approach to be taken.
Ben.
Thank you, Convener. We've gone through the principles, but I wanted to touch on something that Callum Steele raised there, which was almost the concept of suspicion within this whole scenario. And I'm curious as to what steps will officers be expected to take in forming a genuine suspicion that they are likely to find an object during a search. And also in terms of the Federation, I wondered if you could elaborate on your concerns around the issue of suspicion generally, and whether there are any circumstances in which the code will restrict officers' capability and capacity to deal effectively with individuals who may be acting suspiciously.
I think that's a very, very clever question, if I may say so, Mr. McPherson, that the difference between acting suspiciously and having suspicion for a search are two entirely different things. In terms of the second part, you know, how will the code impact on where suspicion exists to search? The short answer to that is it wouldn't make a jot of difference because the suspicion will be the providing principle. But people acting suspiciously, of course, is something inherently different. And whilst I know the example that was provided in the written submission from the SPF was perhaps at the more extreme end of emotions, it was provided for a very specific reason. And that is that sometimes people are acting suspiciously because they're up to no good. You know, they may not have committed any criminal offence. They may not have any article on them. They may be carrying, for example, £10,000 of money as a consequence of organised crime. You're not going to get a smell, well, unless you've got a nose like a cash dog. You're not going to smell that money on them. You're not going to see their pupils dilated as a consequence of them carrying that kind of money. And the ability, therefore, to deal with people acting suspiciously in a non-confrontational way, using your awareness and their ignorance, which is often an advantage, undoubtedly one which the code seeks to address at some point, is going to be lost. So the ability to have that skill is taken away from you. In some extent, the code again probably goes beyond what the law expects, in that that the code is clear that there is nothing intended in what's written to prevent police officers from engaging with any members of the public in any issue. So I could approach you in the street and I could say, all right, you know, what's going on? What's your name? And, you know, all of those kind of things, and would engage in idle chit-chat. The second that I come to any notion that I'm going to search you, I've got to say, what's your name? By the way, you don't have to tell me. Now, that seems somewhat odd that we would be introducing something akin to a second-tier caution, police caution, when we're dealing with individuals. But the whole issue of suspicion, of course, is one side of it, but this... The area that causes the greatest concern for us is the one of vulnerability. And if we consider for a moment that, and to some extent this has got a really strong relevance to the discussion that was had at the main Justice Committee just on Tuesday of this week, about the opportunities to exploit or the dangers of exploitation of some of our young people. When we have, for instance, children and young people that go missing from care establishment, regardless of the provider, there is a danger that some of them are exposed to risk of sexual exploitation. I know that there are inquiries of that nature being undertaken in the service at this moment in time. These victims of crime do not appreciate that they are victims of crime, and they are being exploited by being paid, if you like, through money on a very rare number of occasions, through drugs, through electronics, to phone top-up cards. Now, whilst none of these things in their own right, save drugs, are illegal, we have now got to a situation where the ability to gather intelligence through what was a non-invasive activity, and I use non-invasive in the roundest possible sense because, of course, searching is by its very nature invasive, but it was certainly largely non-confrontational. We have lost the ability to gather intelligence that would support the GERFEC agenda to look after the vulnerabilities of these individuals. And that in itself is a real difficult circle to square when it comes to the kind of activities that we expect police officers to be involved in.
Can I come back on that, please? I'm not sure I would entirely agree with Callum Steele's assessment of that. From my perspective, the use of stop and search, as we've mentioned earlier on, has been fairly ineffective in many ways. The consensual stop and search essentially often didn't find items, so it was clearly not a useful tactic in terms of children and young people. I think the idea that you can police on the basis of somebody's up to no good really moves quite far away from the whole process that we've gone through with the Code of Practice and certainly the progress that Police Scotland themselves have made in terms of accountability, in terms of taking a rights-based approach. I think the Code tries very hard to build in flexibility and to allow police officers to use their instincts, but also to be able to justify those instincts and to be able to give a clear reason for why they're taking things forward. I know at the time when there was discussion around the use of stop and search and a potential new power in relation to stop and searching young people for alcohol, quite often the argument was used that it would prevent crime and it would stop terrible things happening to children and young people. And again, it's very difficult to evidence that. The evidence just was not there that that would be the case. And I think there's a danger sometimes in using the very worst examples of things that happen to children and young people to justify or to move away from something that I actually think is very helpful for children and young people. This Code of Practice is moving us in the right direction, is doing what the UN Committee on the Rights of the Child is saying that we should be doing in terms of being accountable, looking at the way that it's happening, making sure that stop and search itself is targeted in the right way and that officers are held accountable for their actions.
Just one thing, and I think everybody's reflected on it in the response, that at the heart of the Code and one of the key principles of it is that communication and engagement is absolutely the first and most important part of any interaction with a member of the public. And that alone has enormous benefits if it's done well, if it's done openly, if it's done transparently and routinely. And I think the Code definitely advances that agenda. The training we're undertaking advances that agenda as well. And officers are excellent communicators. They're also excellent judges of situations and of incidents. And that comes through usually years of experience in dealing with members of the public and with various scenarios that they have to deal with. And their ability to, for example, gather intelligence comes from a whole host of different approaches and different mannerisms. It's complicated and complex, but the actual engagement and communication in the first place in itself potentially generates some incredible intelligence and really useful information, which I think the Code allows us to focus on, to train officers in relation to the benefit of the wider policing purpose that we seek to to pursue. So whilst acknowledging some of the challenges, I think there is a sufficient flexibility in there. I think the communication and engagement element is very, very important, and I think that's very welcome. And I think it's something that the investment we're putting into through the training will reap genuine benefits, not just in terms of the legitimacy, the accountability, and the trust and confidence that the public have in us, but in the gathering of more technical issues like intelligence. So I think it's the great benefit that is in there.
Okay, thank you. Just before I bring Liam in with a brief supplementary, can I make a plea that members make their questions as brief as possible, and also the witnesses make their answers as brief as possible, because we've still got some areas we need to cover. Liam.
I'll do my best, Convener. Thank you. Just following on the issue of suspicion and acting suspiciously, one of the other concerns I think has been raised in this area from the Law Society is the argument that generalisations and stereotypical images, certain categories of people are more likely to be involved in criminal activity, can be used to underpin reasonable grounds, and that this appears to be at odds with the approach taken south of the border. I mean, I welcome the views of the witnesses on that, whether that's an area of divergence we should be concerned about, or whether it's something that's in accordance with the principles of the code and therefore entirely reasonable.
Sorry.
Could perhaps also answer, because one of the specific concerns the Law Society raised, and it relates to the question that Liam asked, was the use of the word alone. So perhaps when you answer, you could answer that question as well.
Yes, I saw the Law Society's paper, and I spoke yesterday to the head of policy there to better understand that and to discuss it with him. I don't think that there's actually, in practice, going to be a different approach north or south of the border, nor is there intended to be. But the wording in England, if anything, I think is probably slightly misleading. To say never protected characteristics would never be possible as a basis for search, and then to say unless, as it does in England, is really just another way of saying, but perhaps a less straightforward way of saying what we're saying, which is not alone, so none of these on their own. But an example that Callum had given me before, relating to an island that had a Scottish island that had a limited population, and there's a description given by a witness of someone, including reference to what would also be categorised as a protected characteristic. There, it would be possible in terms of the code for the officer to proceed to act and to search, because it's not the protected characteristic on their own, it's the addition of a description of the witness, which is really, again, the same as the position in England. So I think the intention north and south of the border is the same. I think we're a bit more straightforward about it, and I think perhaps the wording in England is more because of the special issues that they've had around race, and so the wording was chosen in that way to address that.
Yeah, that's helpful.
Thank you. Stuart, I thought you were asking. Wanted to ask a question. No, you're okay. I'll just. Pauline, can I perhaps come to you then, and ask if you feel that the application of the code will safeguard children's rights effectively, or is there anything else that you think should be there, or is there some monitoring that should be done to ensure that children's rights are protected?
Absolutely. I think the monitoring that's been suggested by the code is sufficient. I think we certainly had an input into that process, so we're happy from that point of view. I think in terms of the content of the code as well, children and young people themselves were very clear about what they wanted to be evident within the code from their point of view. They wanted a clear explanation of the process of stop and search. They felt that at present, when it happened, they didn't quite understand what was going on. They didn't know what their rights were. And I think the code has worked quite hard to kind of set those rights out. And they also wanted a clear complaints route to be available to them. And I think what we've tried to do in the code in terms of looking at children's rights is we've looked at the need for officers to use age-appropriate language to make sure that they think about the level of understanding that a child of a different age might have, and to be conscious of the fact that that might not always be the same. An eight-year-old might have a different understanding depending on their background and their upbringing. I think it also recognises a child's life experience as well. It makes officers think about it moves away from the idea that you assume that a child has the same life experiences that an adult has. It makes officers think about that and think, is this something that a child's going to be familiar with? And it also thinks about other factors that would influence a child's behaviour. So the power imbalance that we alluded to earlier on between a police officer and a child and a young person, it's very explicit in terms of stating that. And I think that's incredibly helpful because it allows police officers to think about what is this experience like for a child or a young person. It means that they essentially look at whether or not a child has a particular disability that might be affecting the way that they're behaving, a hidden disability in particular. And it also looks at whether or not the child might have experienced previous trauma and how that might impact on their behaviour. So I think what the code does in terms of children's rights is it looks at the wide range of children and young people that police officers might come into contact with, and it equips them with the tools to be able to think, actually, there's something here that I need to think about. I might approach this differently. So from that perspective, I think we're quite happy with it, the way that the codes approach that issue.
And how will information about the code be taken out to organisations that support children and work with young people?
There's two things that we've committed to at the moment. One thing is that we're looking at providing a guide to the code of practice for children and young people themselves, so written in accessible language, so that they will be able to read about it and know about their rights. The other thing that we're looking at the moment, and this is still in the process of development, is whether or not to create some kind of resource that maybe tells you about 10 key things children and young people need to know about stop and search, and to have this in an accessible format, such as an infographic, something that would be easily accessible to them. The other thing that perhaps I should mention just very briefly, as I'm aware we're short of time, is that we're also looking at providing some feedback to the groups of children and young people who inputted into the consultation on the draft code of practice, just to make it very clear. We've talked about some of the nuances today that exist within the code, and it's to make it clear to children and young people where their views have been taken on board and where sometimes we've had to take a slightly different approach to allow that flexibility on an operational basis.
Just before I bring in Rona, I just wanted to ask a specific question, and it's to Mark in relation to training, and it's the training for officers that deal with adults and young people with multiple disabilities or communication impairments. And I know you've said that the training will be given and it's mandatory and it will be refreshed. Are you working with outside organisations to develop and improve that training on an ongoing basis?
Yes, is the simple answer to that. In terms of children and young people, we've worked with a whole host of different organisations. We actually have one of the many groups that we have currently in terms of the governance of Stop and Search specifically is in relation to children and young people, and it's got representation from a wide variety of organisations that represent children and young people. We also carried out workshops specifically with young people themselves as we were addressing our changing policies around Stop and Search, and the feedback from children has influenced the syllabus of training that we undertake. I perhaps should have said earlier that the training that we're undertaking is actually a full day, a half day on Stop and Search, and in the afternoon a half day on mental health awareness and vulnerability. So that isn't specifically in relation to Stop and Search, but it is in the wider piece in relation to how we better communicate and engage with people who are vulnerable, who have mental health issues or other disabilities or language challenges, and that has been influenced through consultation with a number of different organisations. We are evaluating that training as we go, and we'll also evaluate it formally afterwards, and we'll amend it and of course build on it as is appropriate as we move forward when we learn from experience. So I'm confident at this stage that our training is appropriate in terms of covering a whole host of scenarios and equipping officers as best we can with the skills needed to communicate in some very challenging circumstances. Okay. That will continue and be evaluated.
And will officers also have the ability to be able to give feedback on Stop and Search to say, yes, this is what happened, this is how we dealt with it, and it would be beneficial if we did this going forward?
Yes, we do that. We have an online database, which I've described already, and part of that offers a feedback function for officers to be able to contact the National Stop and Search Unit directly and tell us any particular issue or suggestion that they may have. A key element to the application of the code when it comes in will be getting feedback from officers. Okay. Is it working in practice? Are there any issues that you've come across that you felt you couldn't deal with or address because the code, you know, doesn't cover or account for it? And that's a very important aspect of the evaluation of the code going forward.
Okay, thank you. Rona.
Yeah, just very briefly. Just on the issue of a child who becomes distressed during a search, the code doesn't have anything in it that says that the search must be stopped at that point. Would you not have preferred it to have said that, you know, a directive to say that the search should be stopped until an adult is present? Or
We considered that very carefully when we were drafting that, because we did think about whether or not it might be appropriate to stop the search. But again, it was to do with allowing some flexibility. So we would imagine that in the majority of cases that search would stop, someone else would be found to support that child or young person.
So it would be left to the officer to judge?
It would be left to the officer, but the other thing I suppose to say is to go back to what Mark has said in terms of training, that we were very clear that this should form part of the training, that they should be very clear as officers that if a child is becoming particularly distressed, then common sense would dictate that they would stop.
Okay.
I think it also picks up a point that Callum had made in the written submission from the Federation, which is that if the search is going to have to happen anyway, and delaying for a responsible adult to be located was actually going to increase the distress of the young person, then in that situation, that's an example of where the consideration would be towards completing the search, which could be done perhaps quickly. Okay. But the key thing in all of the code in relation to children, as far as I'm concerned, is having the best interests of the child now recognised front and centre, and obviously in the legislation as well.
Okay, thank you for clarifying that.
Liam? Just one of the areas, obviously, where there were specific concern about the move away from any sort of unregulated stop and search was in instances where those under the age of 18 could be searched previously for alcohol. I note in that we've had the consultation and all the rest of it, it does appear as if there's still a question there, albeit that the advisory group, I think, took the view that a new power is not required. Is that because there's a belief that the statutory provision for stop and search is adequate for covering this particular area, as well as the other methods that Mark Williams has identified as being part of the initial engagement? Or are we going to have to come back to this in due course, do you feel?
I think it will depend on the data. The Police Scotland response to the consultation said, let's revisit it after 6 months' worth of data. After some discussion on the advisory group about that and guidance on new baselines, we thought that 12 months would be sensible as well, because actually after 6 months you might not know terribly much more. But it's something that can be kept under review. We made some comment in the supplementary report on the persuasive arguments against such a power, even if the evidence exists. So it's not necessarily a debate or a discussion that's gone away entirely, but it will be driven by data and also by feedback from officers and the views of young children, of children and young people.
Okay. Any further questions? Stuart, yep.
And it's for Mark Williams. Given that this, in essence, as a code, touches upon operations, I wonder if the Chief Constable and the Command Corridor generally is comfortable that it strikes the right balance of politicians keeping their nose well out of police operational matters and the discretion that properly should lie in that command corridor?
Yes, is a simple answer to that. We believe that the benefits that will come in terms of trust, confidence, legitimacy and accountability outweigh any negative. So, yes.
Thank you. Thank you, Kabir.
Do the members have any further questions for our panel? It remains for me then to thank all our panel members today for coming along for what has been an extremely useful evidence session for the committee, and we look forward to working with you in the future. And I now suspend, and then we'll move into private session.